Hello and welcome to The Vote. I'm Andrew Kerr. My guest today is Sophie Cook. Welcome, Andrew. Sophie. You must be exhausted after your campaign.
Well, the election campaign was full on, and I haven't stopped campaigning since, because we never know when we're going to get another election, really, do we?
Well, at the moment, no. Maybe it will happen sooner than we thought. Let's go back a little bit, though. When did you first decide that you perhaps wanted to be a career politician?
Well, I'm not exactly a career politician yet. I've been interested in politics since I was a teenager in the Air Force, because I started to see the world, and I started to see the injustices out there. But, of course, back then in the 80s, If a politician was gay, they'd be outed, they'd end up on the front page of the News of the World. So what chance would a bisexual transgender person have? So it never seemed like a possibility. And then over the last couple of years, I mean, it's only 2 years since I came out, I started doing a lot of speaking, basically to try and change the world, to raise people's perception and awareness of certain things. And sort of opportunities started to become available, and I started to think about sort of the possibility of standing in 2020 at the general election. And then all of a sudden, I'm lying on the beach and I'm looking at the phone, and it says Theresa May's called a snap election. It's like, I'll chuck my name in the ring and see what happens.
So exactly what was the process? I mean, did you go to the local Labour Party and say, hello boys, I'm here?
Well, I already had some contacts at the local Labour Party here in Brighton, and some of them wanted me to stand in Kemp Town. But the process was actually, you had to apply online. So there was, the applications opened at midday on the Friday and closed at midday on the Sunday. And because I was still working in football at the time, I had a full day of football on Saturday. So I ended up writing 1,500 words on the Sunday morning for my application. And put it in, and I got selected for East Worthing and Shoreham.
Were you surprised at that decision, East Worthing and Shoreham? I mean, I know you had hoped to represent us in Kemp Town, but in the end, you ended up in the west of the county.
Well, it was. I did put my name down for two different constituencies. I put myself down for Kemp Town, and put myself down for East Worthing and Shoreham. And see, Kemp Town seemed like an obvious fit for me. But and East Worthing and Shoreham was a bit of a surprise to me, and also to the people that were there.
So did you think that the party were making a peculiar choice, actually, not selecting you for what is very, very well known as being a very densely populated gay constituency?
Well, I think the fact that sort of I didn't have previous experience went against me a little. And I think in a lot of ways they thought, right, let's put her into a seat where nothing's going to happen. I mean, let's face it, East Worthing and Shoreham has been considered a safe Tory seat forever. And I actually had friends over there that were, or friends now that I've made over the campaign, who were very surprised when I was selected. And I wouldn't put it past that certain people to have actually laughed when my name was put forwards, as to thinking, well, this is going to be a walk in the park now. But I like to think that I'd prove them otherwise.
And of course, the Tories had a very, very tiny majority in Kemp Town. Do you think the party probably thought that one's actually fairly safe for us to mop up anyway?
I think that going into the election, because off the back of the polling and off the back of all of the negative press, there was a lot of people that didn't actually think that we were going to do terribly well at the election. I mean, I went, even selected in East Worthing and Shoreham, which was considered a safe Tory seat, I went into it totally committed to the fact that I knew I could win it. Because I don't do just being there to make up the numbers. I was there to win it. And I managed to get people there to totally believe in me. Managed to gather a great team around me that sort of that bought into who Sophie Cook is and what I believe in. And I think that was a big thing. In Kemp Town, they still thought that they had a big fight on their hands, but it turned out that it wasn't as tough a fight as they thought it was going to be.
You've always been very honest about what your ambitions are. When you first came out as being trans, were you prepared for the backlash that you got? Because it's not all been easy.
The thing is, over the last couple of years, I mean, through working in football, I was the first trans woman to work in the Premier League. Of course, a bit of awareness through working in TV, being the first trans woman to be a terrestrial newscaster in Europe. I'd had all sorts of abuse online. I'd had abuse on the streets. I've had death threats online. And I truly thought that moving into...
Death threats must be surely very damaging to your mental well-being.
The thing is, the majority of abuse that I get, I can look at and think, well, that says more about them than it does about me. The death threats were a little bit more difficult to deal with, because when someone goes to those sort of efforts to actually threaten you, it shows that they've gone beyond just a mindless piece of abuse. So they were a little bit more difficult to come to terms with. But I mean, when I moved into politics, I thought, right, brace yourself. This is going to get worse now. You're going to end up getting a lot more abuse. And the reality was, it didn't happen.
Did the Labour Party give you any help, any guidance on how to deal with this? I mean, were they behind you completely?
I didn't get any guidance about it. I guess in some ways they assumed that through my previous profile that I'd be able to navigate the treacherous waters. But the great thing is that the reality was that when I actually entered into politics, the abuse effectively dried up, which really surprised me.
Why do you think that was? I mean, do you think suddenly people were going to take you more seriously?
I don't know. I'm sure that people were saying things. Maybe they just weren't directing it directly at me. I'm sure there's lots of people saying abusive things behind my back. Maybe that's the difference between politics and the rest of the world. Maybe the abuse that I got in the football world was because people there are used to abusing people to their face, whereas in politics they're used to abusing people behind their back.
Apart from in the House of Commons, where they abuse people rampantly throughout all the debates.
Well, I must admit, I have a major issue with that. I think there's a lot of what I would describe as disappointing behaviour that you'd never get away with if you were trying to run a business. So how can you get away when you're trying to run a country?
It does seem very shocking sometimes, watch the House in session and see that sort of abuse. And the fact that people seem to feel that they can actually say things that you probably wouldn't get away with in public.
Well, I've seen various YouTube videos where the Speaker of the House has berated MPs for childish behaviour and sort of playground abuse.
Yeah, and they continue to do it. Running a campaign like the campaign you ran must have actually cost not only in time, but financially it must cost a lot of money to keep these things together. I mean, how did you cope with that? Did you get support from the party?
The problem is that the party and the Labour Party especially has limited resources, and Hove and Kemp Town were considered to be marginal, so they got the majority of the resources. We were considered to be a safe Tory seat. We just got what we could raise locally, a very small budget. And the thing is, I mean, we did a bit of fundraising ourselves. We did a benefit gig for my campaign, which I played my first gig for 20 years at, and we had Attila the Stockbroker playing, and Grace Petrie, and some other guys, and it was absolutely amazing. And I even got to play at Glastonwick. So my first festival audience.
That's Attila's own version of Glastonbury. That's
well,
right.
That's the Southwick version of Glastonbury, which is put on by Attila the Stockbroker, and I mean that was a great experience. But we did our own fundraising. We did a bit of crowdfunding as well, and that all went to help pay for the Facebook advertising and stuff that I did, because we had very limited resources, had to be creative, had to use the things that I was good at. I mean, I shot a lot of campaign videos, and every single one of those got 10,000 views.
So you actually valued social media as a part of your campaign?
Oh, social media was essential. I mean, at the 2015 election, the Labour Party only got 9,000 votes. Well, every single video I did got 10,000, and the main one I did, introducing the campaign, had over 21,000 views. So it was really, really important that, and it also gave me an opportunity to use the skills that I'd learned in television to express my personality and my beliefs.
So it's over now. We're going to go to a break in a moment, and I'm going to come back to the actual election, the process, and how it was on that night after campaigning so hard. But at the moment, you're not actually working in television, sadly for us. And are you going back to the football?
I'm not. I've retired from football. I thought it was time to move on from that. I see my future very much in politics now. I may have ended up with no job out of it, but I ended up with a new career. And to me, that's where all of my focus is going.
Well, we'll come back to that in a few moments, but right now we're going to go to an ad break. This is The Vote, and I'm Andrew Kay. See you in a few minutes. Hello and welcome back. This is The Vote and I'm Andrew Kay, and my guest today is Sophie Cook. Sophie, the actual process of campaigning, going out on the streets, what were the people of Shoreham and East Worthing like?
It was really interesting because, I mean, obviously through being a TV presenter, I was used to getting recognised on the streets, quite often on buses. Charity shops was one of my favourite places to get recognised by little old ladies, having a crafty fry up on a Sunday morning when I've had a couple of drinks on a Saturday night. But never before had I had it where people actually chased me down the road and said, can I give you a hug? And that happened quite a few times on the campus.
So a very warm reception on the whole.
Oh, amazing. But the interesting thing for me was actually the whole process of canvassing, going and knocking on people's doors. Because I've never done that before, and the idea of just going up to a total stranger's door and knocking on the door and going, hello, I'm your Labour Party candidate in general election. The response ranged from having the door slammed in your face, which was...
Did that happen?
Yep, that happened a couple of times, not just to me, but to other activists we had out. And that's nothing to do with being trans, that's just due to party politics and...
That's an interesting fact, actually, because a lot of people I know said when you were standing, is Sophie Cook going to stand on an agenda of gender or on an agenda of real party policies? I was impressed because immediately you were talking policies and actually your gender choice was not part of the issue.
Well, first of all, it's not my gender choice. You don't actually get a choice about being trans. But that's it. I mean, I wasn't there as the LGBT candidate. I was there as the Labour Party candidate for East Worthing and Shoreham. And the important things to me in the campaign are the same things that are important to everyone else that's a parent. The important things for me were education, the healthcare, housing, having things like an ethical foreign policy, make sure that everyone in the country can actually has somewhere to live and decent education for their children and an NHS that's going to make sure that people can grow up healthy. So these were the things that are important to me. Obviously, equality and diversity just run through me like stick a rock. But for me, that just goes as red with the Labour Party. We're a party of equality and diversity. So I didn't think that I really needed to mention that much.
Do you think people were aware that you were a parent?
I mentioned it a few times during the campaign. I even had my kids out canvassing with me a couple of times.
Did they enjoy that?
They're teenagers. They don't enjoy anything. but they were very good. They were very supportive. I couldn't get them wearing Labour Party rosettes. I mean, they were more interested in looking at their electronic devices, as teenagers do. But I think that they, I mean, someone said to me, how do your kids feel about you being a politician? I went, they feel exactly the same as they felt about me being a TV presenter. They really don't care.
At what point in the campaign did you start to think that you may actually be going to make a massive difference to that vote?
Day one. Day one, I was 100% dedicated to winning. As I said earlier, I don't accept just turning up and to make up the numbers.
But was there a point when you sensed that the public were with you on this?
There was a couple of points. I mean, The reception that we got everywhere we went, I mean, we had people cheering us on the doorstep. We had people coming up and hugging us on the doorstep. There's just so much support all the way through from so many people we met. We'd do street fairs and there'd be us in one place and there'd be 20, 30 people around our street store, and around the corner you'd have the Tories with like two. And so I knew that there was this swell of feeling in the country, no matter how bad the press coverage got, because, and this is one of the things for me, that you can lie to the people some of the time, but when you lie to them all the time, eventually they go, hang about, Jeremy Corbyn really can't be as bad as you're constantly going on about. So it was good that, I mean, I could see that we were running a good campaign. We were in a campaign based on honesty, integrity, policies. And I could see that the public were responding to that. And at the same time, I could see that the public was starting to respond nationally as well. So a combination of local swing, national swing. For about the last month of the campaign, I was telling people, we're going to get 20,000 votes. I thought that we would win with 20,000 votes because I thought that Tim Loughton would lose five. But I'm left with the fact of, like, what's the Tory got to do before people stop voting for them? And that's it. But I know that there's at least 5,000 people in that constituency that didn't vote because the Tories always win. Well, we've changed that perception.
So there was the usual complacency that we see.
That's it. I mean, this is the problem with the first past the post system. So many people feel their vote is wasted. The fact that we managed to motivate 21,000 people to go out and vote Labour in what was considered a safe Tory seat is amazing, because it's really difficult to overcome that inbred feeling that after 20-odd years that, you know what, the Tories will always win, so it's not going to make a difference.
What was the turnout in the constituency?
I think the turnout was about 70,000. We had a 70% turnout. Last time it was 63%. I can't remember the exact numbers.
So that's quite an increase anyway.
Yeah, and we had a record turnout from 18 to 24-year-olds as well. Anecdotally, coming from the polling stations, there was people saying they were queuing outside polling stations for the first time ever.
I witnessed the same thing here in central Brighton, that there were queues. I thought that was really inspiring, that actually someone somewhere, and I have to say, we hope it was your party, were actually inspiring kids to get out there and actually vote. But I noticed online there was a sort of swell of young people on social media saying, this is your future, you've got to get off your backside and go out and vote.
I think in some ways the disappointment over the Brexit decision and the fear over Donald Trump's election actually motivated people to go out and vote, because with Brexit, it was predominantly older people that voted to leave, and the younger people are sat there going, but this is our future. Well, if you
get out in that,
you've got to go out and vote.
Let's go to the actual day. I mean, how did your day start, polling day?
Polling day started at 4 a.m. with me sat on the beach staring at the sea, which is basically what I did for every morning for the last week of the campaign. 4 o'clock in the morning, sat on the beach, staring at the sea, just being calm, being focused, thinking about the job ahead, thinking about what we needed to do. And then on the day, I went round, I think about 10, 12 polling stations within the constituency, visited the people that were doing the telling, said thank you for all your hard work. And then came back, got changed, and caught the train down to Worthing for the count. Managed to catch the wrong train, so I ended up like there before the count even opened. Which was interesting, because I ended up popping into St Paul's in the middle of Worthing, because they had a disco on for people with learning difficulties, run by MenCap, which was great, because I walked in there, first people I met were people from Worthing Homes Community House, who I'd met during the campaign, and I'm talking to them about the MenCap event, and it was just a really interesting evening of just bumping into random people around Worthing, waiting for the count to start, and then obviously turning up there and watching all the ballot boxes come in.
I looked at your website, Sophie Cook Talks, which is full of inspiring work, I have to say, and I read this. As I stood on stage, a room full of expectant people looking up at me, I was totally focused on the next words that I would hear. Sophie Cook, Rose Cook, Labour Party, 20,882 votes. How did you feel at that moment?
At that moment, I thought nearly 21,000 people put their trust and their belief in me to stand up for them. And the thing is, we'd been told the result just before we went up, but I didn't hear it properly. So I wasn't entirely sure what the result was. And because I'd said we're going to win with 20,000 votes,
Was there still a hope in your heart at that point?
There was still a hope because I never, ever give up hope. And I still haven't given up hope now.
You're clearly still moved by that response, that turnout of people showing faith in you. Where do you go from here now, Sophie?
I'm not going to stop campaigning. I'm not going to stop standing up for the people of East Worthing Shoreham. I mean, to me, that's 21,000 people that put their faith in me to actually represent them and stand up for them. Just because I didn't get enough votes to be elected doesn't mean that I don't owe them my support and my work. I will work for those people until someone says otherwise, because to me, they put their trust in me. So I'm going to keep pushing for that. I mean, who knows when we're going to get another election. I mean, I'm also working on my autobiography as well, which hopefully we'll be out soon, but there's lots of things happening and lots of things I want to do.
Lots of exciting things in your future. Lots of work still to do, Sophie. Mm. But everyone here at Latest TV wishes you the very best of luck and congratulate you on that absolutely amazing, what I would describe as a landslide result for you in East Worthing and Shoreham.
Thank you, Andrew.
It was an amazing achievement and I know how hard you worked.
Thank you.
Everyone's very proud of you. Thank you for joining me for the vote today. Thank you for watching.